My name is Bruce Murray, and as chair of our Democrats Abroad Global Progressive Caucus, proDA, I am delighted to welcome all who have joined us from the Americas, Europe, the Middle East, Africa, Asia, and the Pacific. We have over 200 RSVPs, a large group, a global group for our event. Closed captioning is available for those who select the live transcription option on the Zoom toolbar. If you have a technical question, please enter it in the chat box and our technical assistant will help you. Greetings also to all Facebook Live attendees who we encourage to comment there during our event. Before we continue, I want to thank everyone who has made this event possible, demonstrating the spirit of not me, us. And in that spirit, also the holiday spirit, I want to encourage everyone to consider donating to our Democrats Abroad and proDA and everyone's work as we end this year and start a very important year. 2022 is going to be a get out the vote year like none other we have experienced. Since the Biden-Harris administration took up its work at the beginning of this year, proDA has followed it closely, enthusiastically supporting its goals for big and bold initiatives to address the crises we face. In the meantime, crucial COVID relief and infrastructure benefits for struggling American families have been delivered. Now, we must keep the momentum going. And that is our purpose today. Over the years, many of us have answered Senator Nina Turner's call to action for election campaigns, issue advocacy, and local organizing. Like her, we believe we all need three things to succeed in life: a wishbone, a jawbone, and a backbone. As she tells it, the first is for hoping and setting goals. The second for speaking out, and the third for persevering no matter how tough the challenge. I witnessed Senator Turner working all three of those bones as she crisscrossed the United States, including where I volunteered in Iowa and South Carolina during the last presidential race. She listens to people, speaks truth to power, and strives tirelessly for that future we can all believe in. That is why we have asked the senator to join us here today. Let's listen carefully as Nina highlights progressive victories, evaluates setbacks, and offers insight on what we can do to support the growing progressive movement in 2022 and beyond. Then, let's start thinking about our New Year's resolutions, stepping up to do what is necessary to take care of our unfinished business. Let's make 2022 a year in which we can build back even better. And with that, I turn it over to our Democrats Abroad Vice Chair, Art Shankler, for his welcoming comments. Art? Art, please unmute yourself.
What I'm doing. Okay, thanks very much. Thank you, Bruce. And I want to thank you, send a thank you to the Progressive Caucus and the Global Black Caucus, the Reparations Task Force, and our new Ohio State team for organizing this event. As a representative of the Democrats Abroad Executive Committee, I want to join Bruce in welcoming all of you to this call. And I'll say, as a fellow child of Northeast Ohio, I especially want to welcome Senator Turner to this call and thank her for speaking to us once again. Senator Turner has been kind enough to speak with Democrats Abroad on several occasions over the years, including, as I recall, at the 2016 convention and on our Stronger Together call in the same year. And it's always been, I'm going to use this word, inspiring. It may be a cliche to say that someone is inspiring, but in the case of Senator Turner, I can think of no better word. She inspires us to think about the world around us, but more importantly, she inspires us to act. To act to change the world around us and make it a better place for all Americans. As you all know, 2022 is shaping up to be a difficult year for Democrats and for America. But if we're to succeed, we need to deliver a message to Americans that we are making a real difference in their lives. And I know that Senator Turner will be leading the way in shaping and delivering that message and helping us elect candidates who will win in November. Her actions over the years as a public official, as a key supporter of Senator Sanders, as a leader in the Our Revolution movement, let me say it again, they are an inspiration. I urge everyone to listen carefully to her words and to act. And in light of Bruce's comments about New Year's resolutions, let me just put in a plug. The first act that you can take in the new year to make a difference in 2022 is to ask for your ballot as an overseas voter. On January 1st, whether you're hungover or not, go to votefromabroad.org to fill in your ballot request form and send it in right away. If you do that, you'll be able to vote in your state's primary and general elections. And then get your friends and family overseas to do the same. With that call to action, I want to thank Senator Turner once again for speaking with us. And I'll turn the mic over to Caitlin Kennedy of the Global Progressive Caucus. Caitlin.
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Art and Bruce, and welcome to everyone on the call. As Art said, my name is Caitlin Kennedy. I'm originally from Texas, now living in Germany, and I'm very excited to be here today representing the Global Progressive Caucus as the moderator of today's discussion. And before we get started, we would really like to know where everyone is calling in from today. Can you let us know in the chat where you are calling in from? See someone from Mannheim, Germany, someone from China, bonjour from Paris, Frankfurt, Toronto, Zurich. Awesome, wow. Sweden, I can't even try to pronounce that. Costa Rica, wow. We're really covering the globe here. Amazing. Fantastic. And we also would love to know what one crucial issue is that brings you here today. Maybe you guys can share if there's one crucial issue to you that you want to hear about today. Voting rights. Yes, Kate, I think we can all agree there. Climate justice, Medicare for all. As we know, Senator Turner is a big champion for Medicare for all. So I'm sure we'll be hearing about that today. Holding on to Congress, yes, we do need to do that. Big money out of politics, yes, Sue. The filibuster, yeah. Build back better, definitely. Yes, jobs for all. The ERA, yeah, women's right to abortions. Yes, definitely under threat right now. All right. And we also would love to know if there are any Ohio voters here today. Any Ohio voters on the call, let us know. Especially what districts you're calling from, what districts you vote in, Ohio 12. Oh, we got a District 11, Christina, yes, nice. Another one, Dawn, fantastic. I'm sure Senator Turner will be happy to hear that she has some of her own constituents on the call, yes, from her own district, Hamilton County. Yes, Robin, those are all important points. Portage County, great. Fantastic. And as we all know, you know, redistricting is happening right now, some big changes. Does anyone know if your district has changed or is changing in 2022? What's going on in y'all's districts right now? Oh, another Ohio 11, fantastic. They're all changing, Karen says. Yeah, but does anyone have any insights to share from their own local districts? Cuyahoga Women's Caucus. I'm very sorry if I butchered that, but that's great, Christina, that you're a member of the Women's Caucus there. Fantastic. Oh, Robin is from Minnesota District 7, becoming more and more right-wing Republican. That's a shame to hear. Karen says it looks like she may be moving to Ohio 3 or Ohio 15, but there's some court actions going on. Yes, I am from Texas, where we definitely have our issues with redistricting, and there are several legal battles underfoot right now, and we'll hope that we can make sure these maps are more representative. Okay. Okay, so what we're gonna do now while we wait for Senator Turner to join us is we have our Ohio State team here as a co-sponsor, ready to share some more about the work that they're doing to make sure that we can really get out the vote in Ohio and make a big impact in the state of Ohio, despite these efforts to suppress the vote and to dilute voting power through redistricting. We have some awesome, awesome volunteers with the Ohio State team who would love to share some of their work that they're doing. So Angela, I would love to turn things over to you now to talk a little bit more about the Ohio State team.
Okay, great, thanks, Caitlin. Good afternoon, good evening, good morning, everyone. If you didn't know it, I'm actually from Ohio, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about our Ohio State team. Go ahead. All right. So our Ohio State team, we've been right now, there are just a few of us, and I just want to give a shout out to Karen and Nikki, who are my teammates. We've been sort of steering the ship for the past few, I guess, months. It seems everything seems longer in COVID time. So I was gonna say years, but it's months. And we're gonna tell you about what we're gonna be doing to try to help get out the vote in Ohio, because Ohio is a very important state that once was Democratic. So next slide, please. All right, I don't know if there was anybody out there from Cleveland, but shout out to Cleveland. Our Ohio team mission is, of course, to help get out the vote in Ohio, at home and abroad. And we're gonna try to do that by connecting with organizers on the ground, the politicians that are running for office, and of course, to reach out to all the Ohioans overseas. And we want to ensure Ohioans abroad can vote and do vote in the midterm. So we're going to try to do our best to connect everyone with all the with votefromabroad.org, with our help desk if you need it, and also with our voter protection team if you're having really a lot of trouble getting your ballot or getting registered. We want to inform our members about the Ohio candidates, and of course, raise awareness about the issues in Ohio, because we have a lot of issues in Ohio. I don't know if anybody saw that Obama documentary, which I cannot remember the name, but it was about an Ohio factory. I think it was called Ohio Factory, actually. And it was very sad. It makes me sad because when I grew up in Ohio, Ohio was a powerhouse, and we did and we made everything. And now we're struggling. And we also want to help win the governor and the US Senate race. And with the redistricting, we're going to try to win some House seats. But, you know, if we can control the big ones, we're doing really good. Next slide, please. This is a little collage we put together of who we're fighting for in Ohio, because I think it's important that we personalize this message. These are Karen, Nikki, and mine, our friends and our families that we're actually fighting for. And we left a space for you and your family and your friends, because we want everyone in Ohio to be successful. Next slide. So the Ohio primary is May 3rd of 2020. And what's on the ballot this year is, of course, the US Senate, the US House, the governor and lieutenant governor, the state Senate, the House Senate, the state Supreme Court, and of course, the appellate courts and ballot measures are going to be there on the ballot. It's very important that if you vote in Ohio, to vote in the primary. We've got to make sure that we have the best candidate for, best Democratic candidate for governor, lieutenant governor, and for the Senate. Next slide. Our first event, our first kickoff event is Saturday, January 29th at 10 a.m. Eastern time, 4 p.m. European time, Central European time. And if you have a phone, this is a great time to take out your phone and do a quick scan and get the event link on your phone and sign up today. We also have events planned for February 19th and 19 March, but those events are not up. After this is done, I'll put the links to the chat in the chat so everybody can sign up. Next slide. And this last picture, if you're from Cincinnati, Ohio, if there's anybody out there from Cincinnati, you know what this is. It's Cincinnati's famous Fountain Square. If you'd like to join us, I'm gonna put a link out so that you can volunteer. If you wanna contact us, please contact us at states@democratsabroad.org. And also you can join our Ohioans Abroad Facebook group. And I'll put out the link for that at the end of this. I'm happy to take any questions if anybody has them at the moment. If not, I will stick my links in the chat and we will continue forward.
Thank you so much, Angela. So much exciting work happening with the Ohio State team and with the other Democrats Abroad state teams. Angela is popping some important links for you in the chat so you can make sure to stay up to date and involved with all of the great work that they're doing. Next, I would like to call on Antar Keith, who is the founder and chair of the Democrats Abroad Reparations Task Force, to share some updates with all of us today. Antar, please unmute.
Okay, all right. Thank you guys. Hi, so yeah, we're doing a lot in the task force. There's lots of exciting reparative justice developments happening at the federal, state, and local level all over America. Whether it's Boston considering establishing its own reparations task force, reparations task force in Louisville, Kentucky, the development perhaps of a New Jersey state reparations task force, and the ongoing developments concerning the recently enacted California state reparations task force, the emerging of a long suppressed American narrative is slowly making its presence known. And with that presence comes a proper acknowledgement of what has happened, a redress for what has transpired, and also a sense of closure. Now, this has many different effects upon America. Its cultural fabric, if you will, and of course, development of its political system and essentially the functioning of that political system as regards those who were historically dispossessed, discriminated against, and made invisible. So what we do with the Reparations Task Force is we try to do one of two things. We try to do educational events to rehabilitate the phrase reparations, to rehabilitate the concept of reparative justice. And also we do advocacy events, whether it's supporting the federal legislation known as HR 40, which would enact a task force at the federal level to enact, to enumerate, quantify, and detail recommendations to address systemic harm, or state level task forces, which at a smaller but no less essential scale, seek to identify key elements of American history and see how these elements, when they have involved discrimination, have created a sense of trauma that has cycled through time and space into the present day conditions that affect groups of people within the United States and their ability to participate in the civic system known as democracy. So we have a slew of events that are going to be happening next year, January through at least April. We're gonna try to get different events where we can talk about reparations, talk to different advocacy groups in America that are advocating for federal and state and local reparations, and also engineer advocacy campaigns for state and also federal legislation. All of this is necessary, and it ties in heavily to progressive politics, and it ties in heavily to Black politics. And, you know, it really is, I feel, the nexus point between progressive politics today and racial justice and economic justice. This is the fight to be in, and we are happy to have that presence here in Democrats Abroad. So if you want to get involved, we're always looking for more person power, you know, we are always looking to bring in new people. You can contact us at reparations@democratsabroad.org. Again, that's reparations@democratsabroad.org. Again, we're looking for you. We're looking for anybody who seeks justice, who seeks a reconciliation with long suppressed narratives of American history, and really just wants the country and its political system to do better. This is the fight to be in. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Antar. Keep a lookout in the chat box. I think there's going to be some important links coming in about how you can contact Antar and the Reparations Task Force if you are interested in getting more involved. And next, I'd like to toss things over to Jazz. Jazz, if you are here, are you ready to thank? I see Jazz is, looks like they're ready to go. Jazz is the chair of the Global Black Caucus, and Jazz has also some exciting updates that they would like to share with us today. Please take it away, Jazz.
Thank you very much, Caitlin, and good day to everybody out there throughout the whole beautiful world that we have. And it is so great to see so many great panelists here today, and also visualizing that there are so many participants as well who are all here to be part of this great journey. We have one more event coming up, which is going to be tomorrow, Sunday, December 12th at 5 p.m. CET, so that means Berlin time. We're going to have a panel discussion on the topic of critical race theory. So what it is, why do people actually want to stop it, what's wrong about the truth, why is it so divisive, and so many more questions concerning that as well. With me together with me on the panel is as well Antar. Then we have Sharon Hatchett, who's the president of the Together is Better Alliance. And we have Gina Harris on the panel as well from the NEA, the National Education Association, which is also the Black Caucus treasurer of the NEA and the Human and Civil Rights Committee chair of the Illinois Education Association. So join us tomorrow, 5 p.m. Berlin time, on Zoom. We do have some more events coming up, but not this year anymore. There are plenty already lined up for January. January 8th, we have a topic called DC Statehood, which is not on the website yet because there's still some small little details being done. Also on Martin Luther King Day, we're gonna have a really, really good event there as well. And there was one more I'm just missing out right now. Also, we are collaborating with Black Lives Matter Tokyo, which is hosting an event as well, together with my vice chair, James Lockett. And all of this will be up on the website actually this coming week. So yeah, that's about it. It's really been a great few months, the last few months, and we had really so many great opportunities to work closely together and be a team. Thank you, Caitlin.
Thank you so much, Jess. So much great work that y'all are doing at the Global Black Caucus. Now, I would like to toss it over to Sue Alksness, who is the vice chair of the Global Progressive Caucus, to let everyone know what we've been up to and what exciting things we have coming for you soon.
Hi, everybody. Great that you're here. We had almost 200 RSVPs for this event, so very popular. We're excited to have you here. I'll let you know that in the Progressive Caucus on December 27th, we're going to hear from author Harvey Kay and discuss his book, The Fight for the Four Freedoms, What Made FDR and the Greatest Generation Truly Great. This is an inspiring call to redeem the progressive legacy of the greatest generation, which, as we know, is now under threat as never before. And I would say, I think we're clear that there's a lot of threats that are even stronger now. I wanted to let you know that we're combining our efforts to put our representatives in the best possible position to win the opportunity to continue leading the fight for economic, racial, social, and environmental justice. And I believe that Senator Turner is with us. Is that right, Caitlin?
I believe I see Kara on the call. Kara or Senator Turner, are you with us?
Hey, it's Kara. Let me check in on her connection. Hopefully she's gonna join really quickly.
Okay, fantastic. As we all know, I think by now in the digital age, there are many technical difficulties. I myself was suffering technical difficulties that luckily got straightened out right before the call started. So we've all been there and we are eager to hear from Senator Turner when possible. So yes, please continue, Sue. I think.
Sure. Yeah. So I'll just let you know that we're hoping that in this season of holiday giving, we can encourage you to contribute to our work with your donation. So your donation will go straight to mobilizing voters around the world in 2022. And we know how very important it is to do that this year. And you can find the links in our chat in a moment. And I'm just gonna check how we're doing. We set a goal to raise $5,000 for getting out the vote in 2022. And so far we're at $501.32. Thank you everyone. So it'd be great if we could get to 550 today. And we'll keep an eye on our donation link there, and here I'm going to drop it in.
If I could just mention, Sue, at today's XCOM meeting, we went over our GOTV plan for 2022, and we went over and approved the budget for 2022 that will support that GOTV plan. It is a multi-pronged plan to get out every vote possible. I've said it before, you know, our membership itself is a major chunk of the overseas Democratic vote. We could be as much as 50% of all Democrats who vote from overseas, maybe even more. And there's a whole bunch of people who voted in 2020 that traditionally would not vote in a midterm election, and that's our challenge, to reach out to all those people who voted in 2020 and make sure they vote in the midterms, because this is what we call an existential election. And then there all those other people, you know, from Ohio and everywhere else around the world who've never voted, either because they don't know that they can vote or they don't know how. And that's, again, part of our challenge for all of us to reach out to them. And we're going to do that hopefully together with everybody and in a variety of ways. So, but it, as soon as it does take money. So
thank you, Art. For sure. I mean, I know that Democrats Abroad tries to phone every member with a priority on members who live, who vote in swing districts and mm-hmm. places where we know there are going to be close races. And so we have we use a system where people can get on the computer, their computer. They don't need to spend their own money to phone around the world. They can get on that system and connect with Americans everywhere and encourage them to vote. And the folks who are our call hub volunteers love to do that. Usually we get a really nice reception when we phone someone. They're happy to hear from Democrats Abroad and they're appreciative of the help we can provide to them on how to vote. Maybe some folks on the call have remember getting one of those calls. It costs money to have that.
Can you put the link for volunteering in the chat?
Yeah, we should put the link in for volunteering. And I'll just say that it does cost money to have a system like that. So that's one of the things.
They go together.
And the workers are free. The workers are all our volunteers. So we've got the call hub system, and then we take out lots of advertising to try to find Americans. I live in Canada, and Americans are hard to find here. There's lots of us, but we kind of blend in. We don't speak a different language unless we're in Quebec. We can be pretty hard to find. And here in Canada, someone had a great idea of taking out bus ads in Windsor, Ontario, which is right across the river from Detroit, and quite a few Americans live in Windsor. And we saw some nice boosts in our uptake in Vote From Abroad, where people do their voter registrations. But bus ads are expensive in Canada, I'll tell you. But it made a difference.
I want to sign back in and talk a little bit more about getting out the vote. And as we know, each of us annually has to sign in again and request our ballots for the election year. And remember, redistricting has taken place and is still going on in 2021. It's really important for all of us to go to our favorite website to see what's happening to our congressional districts. In Central Illinois, mine has just in the last month turned into a kind of a hot dog. See what is going on with your congressional district as you get ready to learn who is going to be up for vote in your district and up and down the ballot. But we also want you to know that proDA is working on its pivotal primaries project. The first primary is going to be in the state of Texas already on March 1. That's another reason to get that registration done for 2022 as early as possible. And we're identifying the key races in Texas, Ohio, and in other states across the country. We're going to be posting information about that in all of our social media on our webpage. We're also interested in following primary forums that are taking place in the United States so you get a chance to see who is running for the Democratic seat. In so many cases, it is pretty much a done deal when the primary is over. I just received an email an hour ago from a candidate in Illinois who said, "My congressional district is the only competitive one in the state of Illinois. And there may be only one in the state of Texas too." So it's important for us all to get in there early and start informing ourselves. And, we're here in proDA going to do our best to help with the process and make sure that we hold our majorities in the House and Senate and really win the opportunity to fight for big and bold legislation in 2022 to continue completing that work of building back better.
Thanks, Bruce.
If I could just step in as a child of Ohio, I grew up in Akron, Ohio, which when I, you know, Bruce said something about the factory and, you know, changing. When I was growing up, all of the tires in America were made in Akron, Ohio. And today, not one is made. I think they've converted to polyvinyl PVCs or something. But They don't make any more. And this is, you know, but this is what, as Bruce said, the Build Back Better program is all about. And we've got to, you know, people are hurting. And we've got to make the case that what Democrats, the Biden administration, what these people are doing is helping real people, is really helping real people. And if we can make that case successfully, I think we've got a good chance of holding on to the Congress in 2022 and picking up a lot of governor's races. And I'll just say one more thing on governor's races. You know, if you look at the three, you know, not Ohio, could be one of them, but if you look at the three, whatever they called the blue wall, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, and Michigan, they all have Democratic governors and heavily Republican legislatures, largely because of gerrymandering at the state level, not just on the congressional level, but on the state level. And it's crucial to reelect those governors in those three states, because otherwise the voter suppression, the outright stealing of elections is gonna happen. You know, those legislatures are prepared to, you know, pass legislation that lets them, or if they haven't already, I think one of them already has, to override the results of the elections, you know, for president. And we just can't let that happen. And I think, frankly, at the moment, the only thing standing in the way is those three Democratic governors in those states. So we've got to encourage people to vote up and down the ballot where they can. And, you know, in some states we're working, you know, where overseas voters aren't able to vote in local elections unless they intend to return. That's an issue that we're pursuing. We've just got news in New Jersey, for example, that they are moving to allow overseas voters to vote in all elections. With that, I think I see Senator Turner.
Is helping real call. People, is really helping real elections.
Yep.
Hello, Senator Turner, are you with us?
I am, good morning.
Wonderful.
How's everybody?
We're so happy to see both of you.
Thank you. We are so happy to be with you.
Wonderful. Well, we have people tuning in all across the world today, and everyone is thrilled that you are here with us. I'm just going to take a moment to introduce our very special guest, Senator Nina Turner. Senator Turner grew up the oldest of seven children to working class parents in Northeast Ohio. She took her first job at age 14 to help support her siblings and keep the family afloat. After working her way through community college and graduate school, she started a career dedicated to keeping Ohio's poor, working poor, and barely middle class families afloat too. Turner made history in 2005 as the first woman to represent Ward 1 on the Cleveland City Council, and again in 2008 as the first Black woman to serve as state senator in Ohio's 25th district. In the legislature, Turner repeatedly defended against attacks on women's healthcare freedom, partnered with organized labor to protect collective bargaining rights, and led the effort to create Ohio's first task force on police and community relations to end racial profiling and police brutality. In 2020, as national co-chair of Bernie Sanders' presidential campaign, Nina built support nationwide for progressive policies like a Green New Deal, a $15 minimum wage, and healthcare as a human right in the form of Medicare for All. She is on a mission to build an America as good as its promise, an America committed to justice in all its forms, racial, social, economic, healthcare, and environmental justice for all of us. Senator Turner, welcome. We are so, so glad that you are here with us today.
Oh my God, Caitlin, thank you so much. You did not have to read that entire bio, and I'm really glad to be here with you all. I love the Dems Abroad so very much. You all have certainly been a beacon of light in many elections in this country, in our presidential elections in particular. You know, I'm definitely referring to 2016, especially when most of us, certainly I know not all of us, but a whole lot of Dems Abroad were very much in support of Senator Bernie Sanders and our movement, because it really is our movement, and it is a movement for justice. So I always, always want to stay in touch with the Dems abroad. So feel free at any time to have me back, me and this little one here trying to get to cooperate.
Well, we are certainly glad to have both of you back at any point. And today we have a lot of great questions from our audience and from our co-hosts on the call. But before we get to those, we wanted to allow you the time to give us an opening statement. Could you please share with us from your perspective some of the biggest victories as well as lessons learned in 2021 and tips on what we can do to support the growing progressive movement as we enter the 2022 midterm year?
Yeah, thank you so much for that question. I think some of the biggest lessons for 2021 also apply to 2020, to 2019, 2018, so on and so forth. The burgeoning of the progressive movement, at least the modern day version of the progressive movement, certainly started with Senator Bernie Sanders' candidacy, and it really caught a fire. And even though in terms of winning the office, Senator Sanders did not win that office, obviously, in 2016, unfortunately, but our movement became stronger. I think our movement also spread. You want to talk about Dems abroad, the movement itself spread abroad. People felt very empowered, even in their disappointment, and empowered, and also I think found a purpose, which is this movement must be engaged in every single election cycle. And why is that important? It is important because the principles that motivate our movement are really human in nature. That we are humanists. That is what we're humanitarians. You know, people want to label us progressives, and no, we're humanitarian. It doesn't get any more humanitarian to want to make sure that people can live a good life. And what are the variables that are included in living a good life? It is clean air, clean food, clean water, having a job that provides you an income by which you can live, not a half measured life, but a good life, wanting to make sure that people can vote. I was listening to, I think it was Art was talking about voting as I was trying to tune in here. Voting is the pillar for all of that, because voting is the way that all of us decide what we want to have happen in our respective communities. So to me, the lesson is those of us who are on the side of justice, and that is political, that is economic, that is social, that is environmental, justice in all of its forms must never relent. I often say evil never sleeps, so good can never take a vacation. That really is what this comes down to. And for every hurdle we jump, you know, I used to run track in high school. For every hurdle we jump, no, I did not jump hurdles, but for every hurdle we jump, as you know, in that race, there's always another and another and another. And that is what it is in life. Every time you clear one, there's another and another and another. And so justice is not a destination. It is a journey. And sometimes it's hard for us to hold on to that, because we're thinking, why are people marching, for example, in DC on a regular basis from different walks of life, primarily led by Black organizations? Why are people being arrested in 2021, standing up for voting rights? You're thinking, didn't we see this bad movie before? Well, what we realize is that justice is not a final destination. It is always a journey, and everybody is obligated to fight for justice, both for ourselves and our time, and also for the next time. So we must never relent. When you are a progressive candidate, you must understand that the corporatist types will do any and everything to try to thwart our progress. Let me give you an example. My race is one example of that, but even the race of like India Walton, some of you may have been keeping up with that race. She was running for mayor in Buffalo, New York, had actually won the primary. Little baby, had actually won the primary, but yet the system itself did everything it could to try to snatch that victory from her. And in fact, they were successful. So as a movement, what we must, I'm gonna send you to go with daddy. Hold on, sisters and brothers, hold on. Okay, all right, you try. Okay, go with daddy. You did a good job, go with daddy. Okay, go with daddy. You did a good job though, baby. Yeah, yeah, I'm so proud of you. You were so good. I'm so proud, he made it a long time. But, you know, so the system itself and the people who represent the system, they are never going to stop. So neither can we. And we have to mount our forces in a very concentrated way so that we leave no doubt that we are, not only are we serious, but that we are organized and that we are agile enough to move as situations change. And then my last point, I know it is very easy to get weary in well-doing. It is. You get frustrated. You keep saying, well, you know what? That system she's talking about is always going to win. So why do we try? No, we must continue to push, because the other side, and when I say the other side, I mean people who think that working people or poor people don't deserve paid family and medical leave. The type of people who believe that the ultra wealthy in this country should not be taxed. The type of people who believe that it is okay for factory farms to pollute, you know, to pollute our soil, pollute our air, pollute our water, who think the oil industry should continue to be in control. For example, Stephen Donzinger, and thank God he is back home and we still have to fight. This man worked with citizens in Ecuador, in the Amazon, won a ruling there, and then all of a sudden Chevron can come in the United States of America and hold this man. Basically, it was a corporate case, and they won for now, but we're gonna win ultimately. So we who stand up for justice can never second guess our purpose, and to the extent that what it means to have everyday people put a little extra on their ordinary so extraordinary things can happen. We're gonna win some and we are going to lose some, but what can never be in doubt is our commitment to continue to push and to continue to fight. Never said our movement was perfect. None of us are perfect. No individual is perfect. No individual is always right or always wrong. But what I do know about this movement is that we do stand up for humanity. That's it. And the things we are fighting for edifies humanity and the ecosystem that depends on human beings to do the right thing. That is what our movement, for sure, that is what I know. So we cannot relent, ever. We must keep the faith and keep the fight.
Wow, thank you so, so much for sharing your insights with us. I think this is exactly what many of us really needed to hear at this moment. Thank you. So for the next portion of our event, a representative from each of our four co-hosts is going to pose a question. After that, we will pose questions from the audience, which were collected in advance of today's event. Then, Senator Turner, you will have the opportunity to give us a closing statement and after the event, in case anyone missed some of the announcements that we were giving at the beginning, we encourage anyone to stick around to hear more about how you can get involved with Democrats Abroad's caucuses, state teams, and task forces. There is so much work to be done in 2022, and we would love to have you in the fight with us. So now diving into our first Q&A session, we have about 20 minutes planned and four questions to pose, one from each of our co-hosts. And the first question today comes from Lee Donald Jazz Moore, chair of the Democrats Abroad Global Black Caucus. In and outside of Democrats Abroad, Jazz has a lot of passion and experience in organizing with marginalized communities, especially African-American and LGBTQ plus communities. So Jazz, please, can you unmute to share your question with us?
Yes, thank you very much, Caitlin. And thank you, Senator Turner, for joining us today. This is really, really great having you here. And also thank you for your very, very empowering, encouraging words that had a lot of spice in it. That's exactly what we need. So the question I was thinking about is, while we're recognizing and celebrating small victories for the big win, this is one way that we can inspire and mobilize our constituency to cast their vote. What strategy would you advise in speaking with African-American grassroots organizations abroad so that they can become the ones to inspire their own memberships to get out the vote? Thank you.
No, thank you. And thank you for such a thoughtful question. I mean, this, I don't have an easy answer for this. It is really we got to meet people where they are, and we got to understand their pain, their hopes too, because life shouldn't just be about pain. It also has to be about hopes as well. I think an undue burden is placed, if I might, sisters and brothers and family and friends, an undue burden is placed on the African American community when it comes to voting. We are always expected to come and save the Democratic Party. We've seen that time and time again. It happened in Alabama. It just happened recently in Georgia. And some of the things that I've been hearing, and I'm not sure if you're hearing that too, is that within the African American community, there's a frustration building because the promises that were made have not been kept, particularly to the African American community. And that's voting rights, even though all Americans should care about voting rights, but we do understand why African Americans have a unique positioning when it comes to fighting extra hard for voting rights, when it comes to criminal justice reform. So we can't even get the George Floyd Act passed, the John Lewis Voting Rights Act not passed, at least in the Senate. The House has done its job. The For the People Act not passed. And so when we are talking to people about voting, we in this movement have to be very clear about the things that are going that are right and the things that are going on that are not right, and that the things that we want to see change, because voters can sniff out when somebody's being a fraud. So we can't be out there saying, oh, everything is fine, you know, oh, this is beautiful. No, there are some challenges. We must meet those challenges. In order to meet those challenges, we need you to vote. Matter of fact, run. Volunteer, do something, even if you're mad as hell. I tell voters all the time, be mad as hell, be disappointed. I get it. I still need you to go to the ballot box. I still want you to participate. I still want you to be engaged. And so that message is universal. It's not just to the African-American community, but it's also to other communities as well, because people are really tired and frustrated. I hear it all the time, and they really want to opt out. And in fact, if you look at voting trends, especially on local level of government, people are voting less and less. And I think that is a sign that folks have given up and they just don't believe anymore. So it is our job, not to bull jive people, I'll keep it PG, but to say to people, we know that everything is not happening the way that I would want it or you would want it, but we must keep pushing anyhow. That's the key. That has to happen. Because you know what's going to happen? The more people opt out and decide that they're not going to participate in the process, it is those very people who need government to work the most. And it is those people who will be hurt the most. The people who have the most to gain are people who are among the poor, the working poor, and the barely middle class. They are also the group that has the most to lose if we do not elect people to office who are true public servants, who care about people over party.
Thank you so much, Jazz and Senator Turner. Our next question will be posed by Angela Fobbs. Angela is a Cincinnati native now living in Germany. She has many, many roles within Democrats Abroad, but today she is here representing the Ohio State team. Angela, please feel free to unmute and share your question with us.
Hi, good morning, Senator Turner. It's so nice to see you. Our question from our Ohio team, which we're working on bringing out the Ohio voters overseas and connecting with people abroad, you know, at home. And what we'd like to know is, what lessons have you learned about organizing in Ohio that you can share with us?
It's hard.
Well, yeah. I know my people. Yes, it's hard.
Yeah, no, it's very hard. I think it's the same answer I gave into the other question, which is we have to recognize where people are and embrace it. You know, sometimes in our passion to get people to participate, and I'm not saying any of us do this, but I've definitely seen in political circles this elitism. You want to talk down to people. Well, why wouldn't you vote? Or why are you voting against your own self-interest? That's not the way to win people over, by telling them that they're either voting in their, against their own self-interest, or shaming them for not being as involved as some of us are. There was something in our lives that sparked us to be more involved than we ordinarily were, you know, 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago. So we have to give other people that same grace. And so what I would say to that, Angela, is to recognize, as you are organizing people, where they are. I also ask people, what do you want to see for the future? What are some of the things that concern you? And weave that into why it is important then that they come out and volunteer, and especially that they go out and vote. But you know, a lot of times we think big name people like myself or Senator Sanders or other people that we can name, people who are elected to the Congress. Yeah, yes, we are definitely good to have on deck. But the most important force, the most important people, the most important ingredient to bringing somebody else along is that neighbor, is that family member, is that friend, is that grassroots leader. So each one reach one. So I want people who are the ultimate organizers to never doubt your own power in motivating and pulling somebody else along, and then asking that person, would you be willing to bring 5 or 10 other people along? And then they ask that person, would you be willing to bring 5 or 10 more people along? And that person and that person. Now you see what we're doing, Angela. We are building, building, building to all of a sudden, baby, it's a tsunami that cannot be stopped. What is old is new again. We have to recycle some of the old school tactics. And you know what example is coming to mind for me is the Montgomery bus boycott in the 1950s. People got together, just everyday ordinary people. And yes, was Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. involved? Absolutely. But because of Mrs. Rosa Parks and others who had refused to sit. See, she wasn't the first one, but she was the first one in that moment that the energy galvanized around. And those everyday people decided, we are not going to take it anymore, and we are going to come together, and we are going to boycott. It was only supposed to be, you know, a day or two, and then all of a sudden, it turned into a 381 days. Do you know how much discipline and commitment? And everybody wasn't down for that. Some folks said, what? You want me to walk to work? Or what? We got a carpool. They were harassed. They were threatened on their jobs. People were killed. But they decided that nobody could shake their resolve. And because of their courage, 381 days, they broke that bus company. You hear me? And so we got to take some of those lessons from the past. Put them, massage them, make them 21st century ready, because we are working for what the past has taught us, for what we need in the present, always with an eye to the future. And I'm telling you, Angela, when you all organize like that, and you start talking to folks like that, and you go, they'll stand up and say, hell yeah, she right. That's what we got to do. You can't sit back. Only all that we love is on the line. That's it. That's what you tell. Only all that we love. Now, you can be mad as hell, but if you sit back, the actions that you don't want to have happen are still going to happen anyway, so you might as well fight. That's it. We got two choices. Either sit back and let this stuff happen to us, or we're going to get in there and fight for what we want to see our present and our future look like.
Wow. Thank you.
Thank you so much, both you, Angela, for posing the question, and Senator Turner for your answer. There is so much we can take away from that as we are going into next year. Now we are going to be turning to Antar Keith. He is the founder and chair of the Democrats Abroad Reparations Task Force. He's a New York voter now living in Germany. Antar, please unmute and please feel free to share your question.
Thank you, Caitlin, and thank you, Senator Turner. As we move forward with reparative justice and the midterms, there are many political actors who feel pushing for this form of justice for Black Americans is not politically expedient or viable at present. Senator Turner, what can you say to those who feel that now is not the time to push for local, state, and federal reparative justice? And how can reparationists show Democrats that rather than hindering campaigns, a push for reparations can bolster their chances? Thank you.
Just simply, and thank you, they're wrong. That's what I will tell them. They're wrong. We ain't gotta play around with this or dance around this. This country knows the debt that it owes to the descendants, the American descendants of slaves, just point flat out. So the longer we continue to play around with this, the longer it's gonna take for this country to truly heal. Restorative justice must happen, and we must have reparations, just flat out. I think for the people who are in this movement, again, whatever the movements are, the base ingredients are the same, that we have to stay motivated and committed to push for justice. Pushing for reparations for American descendants of slaves is simply just about justice. So even if we take the word reparations out of it for a minute, we are fighting for a justice that has not come for American descendants of slaves, period. And let's take this example. You know, two of the last living elders in Black Wall Street that happened in the 1920s, where white mobs, white terrorists came in and burned that city to the ground, killing Black people, tearing up their businesses and the things that they had built and earned. And why was it necessary for them to have their own town? What? Because the white collective did not want Black people in their areas. They were treating them like second-class citizens. They went and built their own thing, thriving community. The last two elders are alive. They are both in their hundreds right now. They go to testify before the Congress. They get an attaboy, attagirl, oh my God, so sad, so cute, so glad you're here. But what they did not hear that Congress say is that we will repair the damage that was done to you and your descendants. Right now, while they're still alive, they're over there, like one is 106, another one is 102 or something. And that would have been the proper response. And that also would have been a foundational point as the reparations movement for American descendants of slaves continue, not to have them come testify so you can check off a damn box. That bothers me greatly. And to look in the eyes of those elders who were children when their city was burned to the ground and not say to them is that we will unite as a Congress, be it Republican or Democrat or it other, to repair the damage that was done to you and repair damage to your descendants who will live a lot longer than you. They did not do that. So that tells you, we can't even get HR 40 passed that the late Congressman John Conyers had been pushing. And that was only asking for a flipping study. So Antar, time out, it's over. Okay, we're not gonna play these games with these elected officials, be they Republican or Democrat. But the reason why I'm saying especially Democrat is because they enjoy over 90% of the Black vote time and time again. And all they do is whisper sweet nothings. Juneteenth, so glad we got it. And you know why? Because the elder who pushed for that certainly had an opportunity to work with her along the way, her family. You know, she had been pushing for this. She's from Texas. She's been pushing for this for a very long time. She wanted to have this happen. I am happy for her that we got Juneteenth. What disturbs me greatly, though, is that when the president was signing Juneteenth into law as a holiday, they could have put something on that. Put some reparations on that. Some direct payments on that. Money to educate Black children on that. From the crib to college. Put something on that. Put money for housing on that. Black folks lost 50% of their wealth during the Great Recession just in 2008. We ain't got to go all the way back. We can start right now with modern times and then work our way back. So it's those kinds of things that must happen. So Antar, what I will say to you and people who are concentrating on that movement, because I know a lot of people have other things that they're concentrating on, but we make the whole, this is about justice. So anybody that doesn't believe in it, does not believe in justice. How can you ever repay? This country would bounce, but I want them to try to pay. Ever repay the debt for over 400 years. And the fact that that kind of discrimination, maybe not chattel slavery, but it's still happening. Look at the legal system that kills Black people. Don't even give it a second thought. Look at the economic conditions. The income and wealth gap is still bigger than my arms can reach. Black children suspended at higher rates than their white counterparts in school. Environmental injustice. If you name all of the injustices, you will find Black folks disproportionately represented in those types of injustices. So we ain't even got to go all the way back. I want to ask our white sisters and brothers and family and friends to be allies in this fight and to stand up and say, you know what, you damn right, American descendants of slaves deserve reparations, and we're late. We are late as a nation in doing that repair. And you know what? Even though the Black Africans in South Africa have not been made whole by any stretch of the imagination, at least that nation had the decency to have a session about it. Right? They had a whole session where people can come and talk about it. We have never done that. Truth and reconciliation is what they had. Now, they still got to go a long way to have some reconciliation, but at least they went through the process. We haven't even done that. There are no anti-lynching laws. We can't get anti-lynching laws passed in the United States of America. But then time and time again, Black folks are asked to come and save this country. No, we over it. We good and over it. That's it and that's all. So Anta, you already know what to do, baby. I'm just putting some icing on the cake. That the movement leaders who really take the front line of this, you already know. I want to recommend the reading of Dr. Sandy Darity's book and his wife, Professor Mullins. If you need to understand why we have to have repair and reparations must happen in this country, the soul of America will never rest. America will never ever be quite right until it pays. Start putting a down payment on the debt that it owes to American descendants of slaves. Hell, starting with those elders from Black Wall Street, because they still alive.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Antar. It is very exciting to see how much movement is happening in the fight for reparative justice at the federal, state, and local levels and within Democrats abroad. That's largely to grassroots support from a diverse community of activists and everyday people who are getting out and saying, we need to talk about this, we need to do something. And Senator Turner, thank you for being a leader in that fight. Our final question now for this portion of the event comes from the Global Progressive Caucus. I'd like to ask ProDA Vice Chair Sue Alksness now, calling in from Canada, to unmute and ask our question.
Thank you, Senator Turner. We know for reparations, for all the issues that are on people's hearts and minds today, how important primaries are. And ProDA, the Progressive Caucus and Democrats Abroad, is laying the groundwork for a new project we're calling the Pivotal Primaries Project, where we're going to be striving to mobilize voters for the midterm primaries. So in 2021, there were some exciting progressive Democrats who experienced disappointing losses after dark money groups and GOP donors started pouring resources into the opposition's campaigns. This is a two-part question. First, what primary races demand our attention and engagement in 2022? Perhaps you could share a couple that you're looking at. And part two, what can we do to overcome the influence of big money in races with progressive candidates?
Oh my God, Susan, I was a victim of that. So hell, 911, what's your emergency? I've been robbed. Oh my God, that you, this is near and dear to my heart because it just happened to me. It just happened to me. I'm gonna answer your second question first. What can we do to overcome this kind of money? We got to have our own powerful money. We got to beat these people. And this goes to something I was saying in my opening. See, they're never going to relent. When they see progressives running, and when I say they, I mean the corporatist Democrats, they will do anything to try to stop us. India Walton's race is the best example for us. So for my dim sisters and brothers and family and friends who are not familiar with that, please look that up. If somebody can drop something in the chat about that race. And the reason why her race is a prime example, Susan, to answering your question, is that she won her primary. Do y'all hear me? She was the Democratic nominee in Buffalo, New York. And that wasn't good enough for the power brokers, for the corporatist wing of the Democratic Party that partnered with Republicans to defeat her in the general, not with another Republican, but with a Democrat. Now imagine if a progressive had a done to a mainline Democrat what mainline Democrats did to India Walton. Imagine that, because that's a little different from my race and the races of other progressives who have been victims of that kind of dark money pouring in to really
distort the will of the voters, because we're talking about distortion. Every group, you know, did I have people who wanted to see me win who did not live in the Ohio 11th district? Yes, I did. But the difference between the people who supported me nationally and internationally through, you know, Democrats abroad who can donate because you're residents of the United States of America. See, the difference between the people who come and donate on our side, by and large, who may not live in a community, is that their donations are to lift a candidate that believes in the uplift of humanity. It's not usually against, like they don't come in totally against that other candidate. They're coming in for. But what happened in my race was it was an anybody but Nina. I was told that from the beginning of the race. 13 people in the race. They said, who are the they? The power brokers, the political power brokers and the finance power brokers said, we want anybody to win this race but you. Y'all tracking with me this morning? Do you understand what I'm saying? And what was my crime? To be an outspoken Black woman in America, to not shuck and jive. When people are in pain, I express the requisite emotion regarding that pain. Imagine yourself out in the middle of an ocean and you drowning. Do you want somebody to ask permission to come and save you, or to find out if it's politically expedient to come out and save you, or to find out whether the leaders of the Democratic Party apparatus thinks it's okay to come and save you? Or do you want somebody like me who gonna come out and save you no matter what the cost? So Susan, back to that. So we have to concentrate. You know, you got me, you touching on something that obviously, if you guys cannot tell, I'm feeling the pain from this question that Susan asked. We have got to be just as, I'm using the word relentless, but I don't mean it in a negative way. And I know sometimes that word has a negative connotation. We have to be just as relentless on the side of good. India Walton, again, I keep using her race as an example. I believe that progressive organizations and progressive organizations supported her, but the progressive movement itself, because she won the primary, we should have been all in for her. That their money would not have mattered. Because we're putting the same level of money in on our side too. That is what is going to happen. And we have to happen. And we're gonna have to elect more people who do understand that dark money in these elections are bad, but until we get that money out, we gotta fight fire. We got to fight these people with money and with people power so that we don't leave progressive candidates out there vulnerable. And then Susan, for what primaries races deserve our attention, I don't want to do that. And what I can do is I can have my team send you all some of the races that I'm looking at. And the reason why I don't want to do that is because I want you guys to kind of look at races and, you know, make your own decision. Can I be influential and say, hey, these are the races I'm looking at? Absolutely. And I have no problem doing that. I am supporting some pretty stellar and progressive candidates. But when I get to start naming them, I'm not going to be able to name all of them. And so I don't want to leave anybody out. So if it's okay with you, Susan, and members of the Democrats abroad, I will certainly have my team share with you some of the fantastic candidates that I am supporting across this country. Because you know what? Even though I did not win my race, and I want to thank the people, the Democrats abroad, the folks that did support me, people from all over this country, our hometown of Ohio, as Angela knows, people came. Ohio was my second highest donor state at one point in the campaign. California was my number one donor state, and the great state of Ohio and New York kept duking it out for who was going to be second and who was going to be third. So, but let me just say my top three donor states were California, Ohio, and New York. But I raised money from every single state plus the District of Columbia in this country, grassroots money by and large. And I cannot thank the progressive movement enough for having my back. But when that dark money, to Susan's point, when that dark money, see, it's the way the money pours in and at what time in the race that it pours in that has the greatest impact. And so when you are running against candidates who only have to put out their good news and they don't have to fight dark money, even if you are the candidate that raises the most money, which in the case of my race, I did, but I had to fight a multi-pronged battle, if that makes sense. And so that is why progressive candidates need progressive organizations and progressive individuals to come to their aid with time, with talent, and with treasure, because we are always going to have to fight harder to win the race against these people. So thank you for that question, Susan. We're making progress, but we got to make more.
Thank you, Nina.
Thank you. Time, talent, and treasure. We might have to steal that, but we'll make sure.
Yeah, I borrowed it from somebody, Susan. I mean, I borrowed it, so y'all can borrow it.
Well, we would very much love to see the list that your office has to share of candidates with us. And as Sue noted in the chat, we are also in the process of developing our own list that Good. We are looking at of primary races.
Crucial well, share primary. Yours. Let's share. Yes, let's share with exactly. each other and see if we have some crossover. And that's a good way of us marshaling our resources through collaboration of supporting similar candidates. I would love to see the Dems Abroad's list.
Wonderful. Okay, so that wraps up the four questions we had from each of our four co-hosts. Now we would be moving into the portion of the event where we had questions submitted by our audience in advance. And we had three questions selected, but we wanna check in with you because we know that you are so busy and you have a very busy schedule. If you feel that
I probably could stay on maybe like 6-7 more minutes. I do have a hard 10:30, so okay. Eastern Standard Time. So it's like 10:20 now.
That's true. Okay, so let's
10:20. Sorry, we're talking to people all over the world.
Yes, some people are in your time zone. Okay. Yes. Okay, then I would say perhaps we have time for an audience question and then a few moments for you to share some takeaways with us. So I think that the first question is that we received was from Tom Sigafoos. He's an Ohio voter in Ireland. And as we all know, voting rights right now are under attack. This is near and dear to our hearts as Democrats abroad. And Senate Republicans right now, they continue to block voting rights legislation. And with that in mind, Tom wants to know what voter registration initiatives are Democrats taking in Ohio and across the country to overcome this voter suppression and these attacks on voting rights that we're seeing right now?
Yeah, there are organizations both in this state and all over the country who are out there registering voters. I can share some of those with you too. I can have my team, because if I start again rattling those off. But I will say the most important thing that can be done besides that organizing, and you're right, to organize people to vote is always important. But you know what is just as important? Getting rid of the filibuster on a federal level. Democrats are in control. I don't understand. You cannot be some of the most powerful people in the world and make excuses when you got everyday people on the grind, making it happen for themselves and for their community. And then we let the most powerful people in the country off the hook, them saying, oh, we can't do it. No, get rid of the filibuster so that we would have more than a fighting chance to pass the John Lewis Voting Rights Act or the For the People Act. That's what we must do so we can put pressure. So as individual organizations are getting people registered to vote, we also must continue to put the pressure on the leaders in the Congress, in both chambers, and also the President of the United States of America to stop playing games and get rid of the filibuster. That's it. And then we will keep organizing and getting people registered to vote. One other thing to that, and I might bump Caitlin because my answers are so long against my own 10:30 timeline, but I think this is important. We cannot sacrifice supporting progressive candidates on the state level of government just to win the Congress and the presidency. And that burns my behind greatly. Because while Democrats concentrate presidential election cycle after presidential election cycle solely on the presidency, which it is important to get, but meanwhile, back at the ranch, in states all across this country, the GOP control most of the state legislatures. And brothers and sisters and family and friends, do you know what happens when you control state legislatures, especially after a census? You get to draw the flipping lines. You get to control what that state's elected leadership looks like for the next 10 years. By and large. And what does that mean? That means that stand your ground laws, laws that take away a woman's right to control her own reproductive destiny, anti-voting rights laws passed. Who knew? So Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, I'm calling on all of them today. For the love of God, please, let us support candidates that are running for state legislatures so we can try to blunt some of the madness that is happening in state houses and governor's mansions across this country while we keep an eye towards winning the presidency and the Congress. Those things go together. We must do those things.
Yes, very true. And just wanted to let everyone know that the other questions that we were planning to ask concerned climate action and what we can do to motivate politicians to take action for environmental.
Hold that thought, Caitlin. First of all, let's join good organizations like Sunrise and 350.org and so many other Sierra Club. Lord, I said I wasn't going to name, but I'm going to tell you something. Put pressure on these folks. And we need to make sure that these elected officials, they have to be consequences. Don't we cannot keep letting these elected officials scare us to say, oh my God, if you don't vote for me, what's behind curtain number two is worse. Mm-hmm. No, what is worse is giving you power and you not using it. We only got one earth. Now, I know a lot of these billionaires and multimillionaires are taking their behinds to space so they can mess it up there. But for the rest of us, for the majority of us, all we got is Earth.
That's very true, very true. And the third question was concerning Biden-Harris legislative priorities, what we need to focus on to make sure these policies are actually passed. So just so everyone knows, the Progressive Caucus and Democrats abroad as a whole, we're going to be working very hard in all these areas in 2022. So now we know that you have a very busy schedule. We're very grateful you were here with us today, and we wanted to give you an opportunity, if you have any time, if you have any short closing remarks that you want to share with us.
Thank you, Caitlin. Let me tell you, Dems abroad, I love y'all. If y'all don't know that, I love you, baby. Mwah, sending smooches. What a way for me to kind of start my Saturday morning. I started it at 5 o'clock this morning with my precious little grandbaby you saw, who decided he was going to wake up at 5 o'clock on a Saturday. And this is the second best start to my Saturday. Love you guys so much. I want you to keep the faith and keep the fight, baby. But this is my close. So I decided to pull something from the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. because I think this encapsulates all that we have been discussing today. And he said these words: power without love is reckless and abusive. And love without power is sentimental and anemic. Power at its best is love implementing the demands of justice, and justice at its best is power correcting everything that stands against love. Baby, that's it. Power and love go together. And it is important that you are asking the types of questions, by and large, it was about how do we get the power so that we can stand up for what we love. That's what this is about. How do we get the power so we can stand up and fight for what we love? So don't let nobody tell you that power and love don't go together, baby. It does. And the Reverend Dr. MLK said it better than anybody else can say. So I want you to take that quote. Somebody put that quote in the chat, and I want you to say it to yourselves every single day. We must get the power so that we can implement policies of love. What are those policies of love? I'm glad you asked. It is Medicare for all. Hello, somebody. It's paid family and medical leave. Hello, somebody. It is making sure that women can control their reproductive health. Hello, somebody. It's canceling student debt. It's dealing with climate change in a way that saves money. Mother Earth and repairs her for ourselves and for future generations. It is reforming a legal system that is working as it is designed. It is about securing reparations for American descendants of slaves. Hello, somebody. It is about college for all. Oh, yeah. Power and love go together, and you all are more powerful beyond measure. I love you, Dems Abroad. I ain't even got a workout today. Thank y'all. I done got my workout in already. Please have me back anytime, and I will definitely make sure that my team shares with you who I'm endorsing right now. It'll be a rolling list. I can't wait to get your list, and thank each and every one of you for everything that you do. No matter what, even if we get a little miffed with each other, we must absolutely stay together and continue to keep the faith and keep the fight. So much love, Dems Abroad. I love you.
We love you too, and we are so, so glad that you took the time to be with us here today. I think we all have so much to think about from this conversation. And now I'd like to turn things over to Sue Alexness from the Global Progressive Caucus.
Oh man, we have got the love, folks, and we have got the power. And we've got to put them together and march to Nina's tune. She has got us ready to go, ready to move forward and continue our work to make a difference in this world every day with our work. So please, I invite you to join the Progressive Caucus. We'll continue to collaborate with our fellow DA caucuses, the task force, the forces and councils. We want to complete that unfinished business of building back better with love, with power. That includes passage of the Freedom to Vote Act, the John Lewis Voting Advancement Act. And it also includes the great work of our Global Black Caucus. They're hosting a critical race theory event tomorrow online. The Reparations Task Force, which is fighting for passage of HR 40 by the end of this year. So connect with them to find out more. And our Ohio State team, thanks team. And they're officially launching in January. I think we can drop links to those events in the chat. Invite our co-host to go ahead and drop your links in for those activities as well, so everybody has that information available. The Progressive Caucus has an event on January 8th, our Progress for Progressives meeting, which happens once a month, where we talk about the unfinished business and plans to move forward and concrete actions we can take to embrace our power and let love flow. So I just put in a final plug to let you know that we're going to continue to work on leading the fight for economic, racial, social, and environmental justice. And we ask you to consider making a donation if you haven't already. I think we reached our 550 goal for today. So if anybody wants to bump us up to 600, that would be amazing. It'll help to, we just put a 561. So this enables us to reach voters all around the world. Thank you so much to everyone who made the event possible, Kara Turrentine and the entire team in Senator Turner's office, everyone at Democrats Abroad. I think probably about 20 people helped put this event together, and our co-hosts, and especially Senator Nina Turner for all she does to build our Not Me, Us movement. All right, so I think our co-hosts maybe have a couple quick announcements to make. Angela, did you want to throw in a few quick last words?
Okay, I will. As Caitlin said, I've got a lot of hats on, and I put a link for Senator Turner talked about the environment. As some of you may know, the Democrats Abroad now has an Environment Climate Crisis Council, ECCC. And if you'd like to join, I put that link in the chat. It's important that we get as many people as possible behind us to support this. And I know we have the Progressive Caucus behind us for sure, 100%.
Thanks, Angela. Angela. Jazz left us, but Antar is still here. And Antar, do you have a few sentences to send folks on their way? Oh, looks like Antar might be.
Oh, yeah. Hi. Yeah, I'm here. I'm here. I'm here. I'm operating on my cell phone, so it's a little like rougher, but I have what I want to say in front of me. You know, I hate speaking on a script, but here goes nothing. Democrats abroad, in cooperation with the Global Progressive Caucus and Global Black Caucus, are now committed to meeting the rising challenges facing Black Americans through a collective push for the acknowledgement, redress, and closure for Black trauma in the United States. Do this we must, for time is short. Heeding the call for real action in the face of structural racism, DA has powerfully thrown its weight behind the Commission to Study and Develop Reparation Proposals for African Americans Act, known as H.R. 40. This bill would enact a commission to begin researching how Black Americans have suffered under racialized terror and political suppression, and would then make recommendations for redress. The Reparations Task Force is looking for Democrats abroad members who are driven and motivated to jump into the fight for full reparatory justice for Black Americans. We're looking for volunteers who wish to support H.R. 40 and all other American reparative legislation at the local, state, and national levels. If you're interested in getting involved in this fight for justice, as Senator Turner put it, just justice, please send an email to reparations@democratsabroad.org indicating your name, country committee, and what reparative justice means to you and why you are passionate about it. Thank you.
Thank you, Antar. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Thank you to our co-hosts, the Global Black Caucus, the Ohio State team, and the Reparations Task Force for Democrats Abroad. Remember to share your number one New Year's resolution with your networks. It's to register to vote on January 1st. Thank you. Let's all take good care of each other with progressive policies for economic, racial, social, and environmental justice. Thank you, everybody.